IVM.
Hello and welcome to the Ganatantra podcast. I am Alok Prasannakumar.
And I am Saryu Natarajan.
Continuing with our mini-series of two episodes on the abrogation of Article 370 by the Indian government, we have with us Dr. Andrew Whitehead to speak to us about the history and the politics of the abrogation of Article 370. You may recall that in our previous episode, we discussed the constitutionality and legality of this move. And in this episode, we thought we'd give a bigger picture of what lay behind this move and what lies ahead for Kashmir.
Absolutely. Andrew Whitehead was for many years a journalist for BBC News. He spent 4 years as the BBC Delhi's correspondent and was later editor of BBC World Service News. He is now an honorary professor at the University of Nottingham in England and also teaches at the Asian College of Journalism in Chennai. He has a PhD in the 20th century history of Kashmir and is the author of A Mission in Kashmir and more recently The Lives of Frida, the Political, Spiritual and Personal Journeys of Frida Bedi. Welcome, Andrew.
Thanks, Saryu. Hi, Alok. Very pleased to be on the Ganatantra.
Yeah, welcome to the podcast, Andrew. So I thought, I just read your interview with the caravan. And you did mention, make a very important point that, you know, for the reasons and what has happened with regard to the repeal of Article 370, you know, maybe the claims with what happened in the 40s and 50s may not be so relevant, but I thought it would be relevant for our viewers to understand what actually happened in the 40s and 50s, how all the parties to the Kashmir issue frame these series of narratives.
Absolutely. Also, the understanding of the delicate balance on which 370 rests comes from this historical understanding. So we'd love to hear from you on this.
Well, it was a very complex time and there was a great deal of confusion about the status of Kashmir. I think the British, as they were departing South Asia, rather assumed that Jammu and Kashmir would go to Pakistan simply because the logic of partition, which is that adjoining Muslim majority areas become part of explicitly Muslim Pakistan, pointed very much towards Kashmir's accession to Pakistan. However, the Maharaja, although he at one time did consider joining Pakistan, was more pulled towards joining India, though I think it's quite clear he'd really have preferred independence. And when in late October 1947, there was an invasion of armed Pakistani tribesmen, clearly operating with the consent and support of at least sections of Pakistan's army and government, that really spooked the Maharaja, and he signed up in a rush to India, and that was mainly to achieve an airlift of Indian troops which would protect his capital, Srinagar, from the invading forces. But the important thing that I think you need to remember as well is that Sheikh Abdullah, the great radical Kashmiri nationalist who had only just been freed from the Maharaja's jails, also at that time supported accession to India. But the manner in which the accession was achieved, the basis in which it was achieved, was different from the rest of India. So Jammu and Kashmir did not become part of independent India on the 15th of August 1947. But about 10 weeks after that, there were particular discussions. The accession document was the same that other princely states signed. But Article 370, when it was approved by India's Constituent Assembly in 1949, was basically part of an understanding between Delhi and Kashmir to ease this Muslim majority former princely state into the Indian Union.
And that's I think, the interesting point. And I suppose in some ways that has been And I think the last thing that you said, the fact that this was the way in which a Muslim majority nation was made part of India, I think that was used as a sticking point by a lot of Hindu nationalists, even right at the right then, Shyama Prasad Mukherjee and others. But coming to the point about how did Kashmiris approve this, and at this I think you mentioned a very important point about Sheikh Abdullah also being in favor of accession to India. How was Article 370 perceived? Because you did have a constituent assembly in Jammu and Kashmir, which ostensibly drew up a constitution for Jammu and Kashmir itself. But what was the Kashmiri understanding of what this article presented?
In 1949, when India's constituent assembly passed Article 370, it did so with really very little debate and no opposition. It was simply something proposed by the Indian government, and it went through not quite on the nod, but not far off.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You're right in saying that shortly afterwards, the Hindu nationalists raised strong objections to this privileged status for Jammu and Kashmir, and that has remained the case ever since and in repeated BJP manifestos. But it would be wrong to imagine this has been contested all the way through. And similarly, in Jammu and Kashmir, there wasn't a great deal of discussion about Article 370 at the time it was passed. And as you say, in the early 1950s, the state, the former princely state, had its own constituent assembly, which was supposed to come up with an enduring status for Jammu and Kashmir. And in his opening speech to that constituent assembly, Sheikh Abdullah, he laid out all the options, Pakistan, India, and even independence, which wasn't a formal option, but could have been pursued. And he said, look, the government of India has not interfered with our autonomy, meaning in the previous 4 years. So he was pointing very strongly in his speech towards the Constituent Assembly going with India. The strange thing is, at the same time, we now know that Sheikh Abdullah was having conversations with foreign diplomats and on occasions giving media interviews, including rather strangely with the Scotsman newspaper, in which he was talking up the option of independence. And that's basically what led to Sheikh Abdullah's dismissal and arrest, clearly on Delhi's initiative, in August 1953. And if there was a fall from grace, I mean, that was it. That was the moment when Delhi's interference in Jammu and Kashmiri politics became evident. And to be honest, that interference, I mean, it's ebbed and flowed, but it's remained a persistent factor of politics in Jammu and Kashmir ever since. I mean, it's now really, in a sense, unthinkable for anybody to take the place of chief minister in Jammu and Kashmir without a level of approval and consent from Delhi.
Yes, and in some ways, 370 has been post the approval of the Constituent Assembly and post it being passed by the Constituent Assembly in India. 370 has been the backdrop of much of the political imagination of Kashmir and sort of even the broader imagination of Kashmir in the context of Indian politics. Could you speak to a little bit about how that has shaped up over the course of the last three or four decades? There have been sort of rises and falls in insurgency. Post 2014, there seemed to be a dip in sort of military incidents in Kashmir. But 370 has been at the backdrop, and sort of perceptions around 370 have also had their ebbs and flows around it. So that delicate balance and how and why 370 continued to exist in the way that it did, could you speak a little bit to that as well in the context of what has happened today?
Yes. So Article 370 on paper gives Jammu and Kashmir a huge amount of autonomy. But in fact, it's been hugely diluted over the decades, particularly in the course of the 1960s. Initially, Jammu and Kashmir had its own prime minister, as well as constitution and flag. In the 60s, that title was changed to chief minister. It had a great deal of power to create its own laws. It meant that India-wide institutions such as the Supreme Court and the Election Commission didn't necessarily have authority over Jammu and Kashmir. But most of that has long since gone. So the abiding importance was in a number of fairly minor aspects. So yes, Jammu and Kashmir still has its own constitution. It still has its own flag. It has one or two anomalies in the way in which it's governed. And indeed, it is able to define state subjects and give them particular privileges. And that particularly applies in the right to settle in the state and the purchase of property. But it's wrong to imagine that Article 370 has been a matter of active debate all the way through. When I started going to Kashmir in the 1990s, nobody talked about Article 370. It was just taken as a given. And it was the rise of the BJP and its insistence in repeated manifestos that it was going to scrap 370, which has brought the article back into focus. But even then, I mean, I was reading an interview with A.S. Dullett, who worked, I think he was an intelligence chief under Vajpayee. And he was saying that actually in Atal Bihari Vajpayee's time in charge, there was no discussion at all in Delhi about 370. There was no discussion about scrapping it, not that he was party to. It was just taken as there. And there's lots of things which the BJP might aspire to do, but that doesn't mean to say that necessarily they wish to do it. And I was rather surprised that Amit Shah announced the scrapping, what amounts to the scrapping of 370, because in practical terms, it doesn't mean very much at all. Its real importance is symbolic. I mean, symbolic, certainly for the BJP. It's a measure which has clearly enthused the rank and file, and indeed attracted a lot of support across India from people who are not the natural BJP constituency. The way in which it's been done and the dividing of the state, its downgrading to union territory status, has for different reasons got a lot of backing in Jammu and in Ladakh. But entirely predictably, it has been attracted a furious response in the Kashmir Valley, which is the heart of the state and is, as you know, 98% Muslim. And the Indian authorities clearly knew it was going to have a very, very negative reception, because they sent in tens of thousands of extra troops. They told tourists and yatris to leave. They ordered schools and colleges to close. They switched off the internet. They stopped telephony, both landlines and mobile phones. And the really big and, I think, rather sinister thing, they also arrested or detained a large number of people, including mainstream political leaders who are, in shorthand terms, pro-India. So Omar Abdullah and Mehbooba Mufti are both former chief ministers of the state. They're both considerable political figures. Neither advocates violence. And both at times in the past, at different times, have been allies of the BJP. So to arrest people of that magnitude, that's a very, very serious move indeed.
And this is what sort of surprises me to an extent. I mean, of course, the move was announced all of a sudden. The move was announced overnight. Nobody expected it until, I think, literally till Amit Shah stood up to read out what they were proposing to do. But in a sense, it doesn't seem to be like there is any escape hatch the Indian government has left itself with, that they are so sure of being able to, at least they seem to think that they will be absolutely sure of, and they're so sure of containing any political fallout from this particular move, that they don't need to, have backups or keep some channels of communication open, or, have somebody who can play the role of an honest interlocutor, that in a way they have accidentally internationalized the dispute, because nobody in Kashmir can afford to speak for India. It can only be somebody who's non-Kashmiri or who can say that we are speaking on behalf of India.
Who's accepted by Kashmir?
I mean, I think you're right in saying that, Amit Shah and Narendra Modi have pulled the rug from under the constitutional, broadly pro-India political leaders in Srinagar. And basically, they seem to have decided that they're going to govern the Kashmir Valley without consent. You could say that's been happening for quite a long time, one way or another, but nevertheless, there seems to be now no desire to govern Kashmir by consent. But in terms of internationalizing the issue, the strange thing is we've had a very angry response, entirely predictable, from Pakistan, critical words from China, but the United States, Britain, other Western powers have been very, very mild in their criticism. And they've criticized not so much the revoking of Article 370, but what's been happening on the ground in Kashmir, the curfew, the arrests, the closure of schools and colleges, the switching off of virtually all communications. So I think that's a sign that actually, whether sadly or otherwise, the West is not going to get involved in this. Pakistan's response is going to be, I think, largely rhetorical and diplomatic rather than anything else. So I don't think this is going to lead to a significant internationalization of the dispute, but it is going to mean that certainly for the foreseeable future, I mean, politics changes in ways that you don't expect, but it's very difficult to see how any significant, substantial Kashmiri political leader is going to engage actively with the Indian government. It looks like for some time now, for some time in the future, that simply isn't going to happen.
And that sort of also tells us a little bit, I guess that also gives us a good way to sort of think about what do they really hope to achieve? Because in a sense, just to clarify, for those who may not be aware, while Ladakh has gotten union territory status with no legislature, that means it'll be directly ruled by an administrator appointed by the union government, Jammu and Kashmir, the rest of the state, will be a union territory with a legislature. So there will be elections. I suppose in Jammu there will be fairly enthusiastic participation in the elections. And however the seats post delimitation are allocated, I don't see that the elections will afford any legitimacy to any legislative council or anybody, because I see that even with the Lok Sabha elections, we saw dismal turnouts in the Kashmir Valley, and I think it'll be even more, even less participative in this time. So I suppose maybe this move was aimed to appease Jammu, but there doesn't seem to be any place for the Kashmiri voice or even anything that we'd want to use to negotiate with the Indian state.
Yes, I think that's right. There has been a respectable turnout in the Kashmir Valley for state assembly elections in the past, not as high as in other parts of the country, but higher than in elections for the Lok Sabha. I'm not quite sure exactly what the plan of the BJP is. There has been talk of a delimitation, in other words, a redrawing of constituency boundaries in Jammu and Kashmir, and possibly the allocation of seats to represent those people who moved east from what became Pakistan Kashmir in 1947. Mm-hmm. And those people are largely Hindus who then settled in the Jammu region. Now, it's just possible, if that was done, that Jammu might have more seats in the Legislative Council than the Kashmir Valley, which would be a change from the way that, you know,
things are now.
You do it on basis of current population. And that could be a way of giving Jammu the louder voice within any Legislative Council. But we don't know that. Yeah. I think the BJP would quite like to achieve that if they could. Mm-hmm. I think you're right. Whenever elections are held, and I can't imagine that's going to be any time soon, I think turnout in the Kashmir Valley may well be very low. And whoever wins those elections within the Kashmir Valley is going to have limited political authority or credibility.
Yes.
We can't be sure of that. There are all sorts of currents emerging in Kashmiri politics. The rise of Shah Faisal, this former IAS topper who resigned from the IAS and was clearly about to set up his own political movement in the Kashmir Valley. Mm-hmm. We don't know quite which way he will go, but certainly he's been tweeting a little bit in recent days. I'm not sure how he's managed that, but he has. And he's expressed a profound sense of anguish and anger over the scrapping of 370 and the way in which it's been done. So the long-term game, I can't really see. And I'm not absolutely sure that very much thought has been done to it. Given to it. I think one of the factors behind the scrapping of 370 was simply that of timing. Mm. It's much easier to scrap Article 370 when the State Assembly is not sitting and there no democratic government of the state. Clearly, that is the case at the moment. There is a president's rule there. I think the other thing that may have been a factor, and some people suggest was a factor, at least in the timing, was these rather curious remarks by President Trump suggesting that the Indian government had asked him to mediate on Kashmir. And I think the change of status is a very good way of saying, forget it, it's not going to happen.
Mm. Yeah, and I think quite a few people did mention that particular point. In terms of, and like, just for those may not be aware, I think the broad point being made here is that because the US needs to deal with Pakistan for any final settlement in Afghanistan, Pakistan's bargaining chip was get India to come to the table for bilateral or multilateral talks on Kashmir. And the response here may have been that no, just take this bargaining chip off the table by saying that no, Kashmir, now we have settled the Kashmir dispute one way or the other and nothing can be done. But I suppose in that way, given Pakistan's response and reaction, of course, as you mentioned, it's rhetorical and still largely diplomatic. I wonder if, you know, the Afghanistan angle to this won't go away entirely in the next 12 months or so. That Kashmir may still be used, because we see that there is also, I suppose, a level of groundswell of anger in Pakistan as well. Not just in terms of the elites or in the governments. There seems to be a groundswell of response, because it is the whole idea of Kashmir being central to the identity of Pakistan and who they are. Now, if Pakistan is seen to be doing nothing, that has a more profound impact on Pakistan itself. So I wonder if this angle of this involvement of, say, the issue in Afghanistan and Pakistan may not be done in the next few months.
There's clearly things happening in Afghanistan which will have some wider knock-on, especially if the Taliban come in from the cold. Sure. That would be seen as something of a diplomatic victory by Pakistan, and it would allow President Trump to announce a more or less complete, probably, withdrawal of American troops in time for his re-election campaign. There's clearly been a sort of proxy battle between India and Pakistan for influence in Kabul, and it would give Pakistan an advantage over India. And some might see Kashmir as another territory where India is trying to gain an advantage to balance the prospective disadvantage in Afghanistan. So all that's possible, but I think you can sometimes just read too much into that. And I think we just simply don't quite know what the bigger game is.
Yeah, and of course, there's always the explanation, because there are assembly elections coming up, that the move was aimed at a domestic audience as well. There are 3 assembly elections coming up in the next few months, where in one state, I think the BJP hasn't done well. So this is move aimed at consolidating voters amongst that set of voters as well.
I think there's a lot in that. I mean, clearly the number of parties which are not allies of the BJP, who have broadly endorsed the revoking of 370, from Aam Aadmi to the BSP to the TDP, it's quite striking. And this is a move which has sort of captured attention and approval through almost all of India, apart from the Kashmir Valley. And I think that's really quite important. And it gives the BJP a political advantage at a time when its main nationwide opponent, Congress, is really in a deep mess. It doesn't have any leadership. It doesn't have any policy. It has very little credibility. And I think they're trying to take advantage of that. Mm-hmm. I think the other thing that I just, while we're talking about Pakistan, it's just worth remembering that, yes, a lot of Pakistanis do feel fervently about the future of Kashmir and have taken to the streets about the revocation of Article 370. But there has been a different approach from sections within Pakistan not all that long ago. I'm thinking about President Musharraf's 4-point plan, which he raised with India and got a fair bit of approval from the Indian authorities about, 10, 12 years ago, which foresaw both India and Pakistan simply keeping the part of the former princely state that they currently control, but making that a permeable border with people and goods able to cross from one side of Kashmir to the other, a partial withdrawal of troops, particularly from the big urban areas in the Indian side, and both India and Pakistan having a sort of watching brief on what happens on the other side of the current line of control. Really interesting idea. It was a Congress government, Manmohan Singh's government, which gave a fairly positive reaction. Mm-hmm. The BJP at that time did not express serious misgivings. They just waited to see how the issue would develop. And of course, what eventually happened is that President Musharraf lost power in Pakistan and the whole plan fell. But it was a very interesting move, and it's the closest that Jammu and Kashmir has come to a geopolitical resolution since 1947. But that suggests that alongside this sort of atavistic loyalty to Kashmir that many Pakistanis feel, there are also at least some people there who are willing to, or at least have thought about, cutting a deal, which means that Pakistan would get rather less than it's sought over the past 70 years.
So I guess that sort of brings us to the end of this particular episode. And I think we've covered a lot of terrain in terms of not just the history of this particular provision of the constitution, but also what lies ahead in terms of the domestic politics and the international implications of a move like this and what might have prompted it. Of course, maybe a lot more remains to be found out as we go ahead in the future as to what real motivations went in to place to find out. And things will become more clearer. But I guess in no way can it be said that anything about Kashmir is quote unquote closed or a done deal, or is just a matter of following through the consequences now as after Article 370 has been abrogated. And in that sense, I guess there will be much more to talk about and more to think about in the context of this. Thank you once again, Andrew, for having joined us. It was most instructive and very illuminating to listen to you.
Thank you, Andrew.
Thank you. I enjoyed the conversation.
Thank you. Thank you all for tuning in. We will now officially resume our hiatus and we should be back with more episodes shortly.
Janice, what do you think couples did before TV was invented?
I don't know, go for walks on the beach, long drives, fancy dinners, have more sex maybe?
But what did we do when we decided to move in together? We debated between the Chromecast and the Fire Stick.
We gave up on sleeping early so we could stay up watching true crime shows.
We got ourselves three cat babies.
And basically became the cutest couch potatoes around.
Okay then.
In case you guys still haven't got it, we are a TV crazy, Netflix loving, binge watching Mr. and Mrs.
I'm Anirudh Guha.
I'm Janice Iquera.
And if like us, you snort TV for breakfast, lunch and dinner, this is the podcast for you.
Tune in every Thursday on the IVM Podcast app or wherever it is that you get your podcast from. This is
Mr.
and Mrs.
Binge Watch.
Are you constantly seeking happiness? Wondering how to make the most of every day? How not to let your inhibitions stop you from achieving your goals? It's now time to get your A-game on. It's time to unlock your true potential. Tune in to the empowering series with me, Zarina Poonawalla, to feel empowered in all genres of life. From behavioral skills to management skills, from health to relationships, from mental well-being to emotional well-being, and of course your finances. I've got you covered. With these tips and tricks from me, Zarina, and true life stories from my amazing guests, you're bound to bring your purest to the table. Tune in to the empowering series with Zarina Poonawalla every Thursday on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you listen to podcasts.